Good evening, everyone. Greetings from Department of Computer Applications, Francis Xavier Engineering College. I welcome you all for this live webinar session by Dr. S. Sivagurunathan, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Applications, Gandhigram Rural Institute, Dindigul. To seek God's blessing, let's start this session with a word of prayer. Now, I request Mrs. S. Jasmine Mary, Assistant Professor of MCA Department, to lead us on prayer.
Our most precious and heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for all the blessings you have showered upon us. Bless the resource person and all the participants of this webinar. Let your name be magnified and your little will be done. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I request Mrs. C. Mahadevi, Assistant Professor of MCA Department, to welcome the gathering.
Good evening, one and all present here. First of all, I would like to thank our alumni for this program. I thank our management, STAT Group of Institution, and Professor Planning and Development, Principal of Francis Xavier Engineering College, for their continuous support, motivation, and guidance for this webinar. I welcome our eminent resource person, Dr. S. Sivagurunathan, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Application, Gandhigram Rural Institute, Gandhigram, Dindigul, for his valuable presence. I extend my hearty welcome to the participants from various colleges, industries, and also from Francis Xavier Engineering College and our department HOD and our faculties for this webinar. Once again, I welcome you all for this webinar, Emotional Intelligence and Cognitive Abilities, organized by the Department of Computer Applications, Francis Xavier Engineering College. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I request Mrs. D. Angeline Renjithamani, HOD of MCA Department, to introduce our eminent resource person.
A very good evening to one and all present here. First of all, I would like to thank our Almighty God for this live webinar. Then I would like to thank our management, STAT Group of Institutions, Professor Planning and Development, Dr. Jayakumar, Principal Dr. V. Velmurugan, and the fellow faculty members of our department for this webinar. Determination is nothing without dedication and hard work. It's a great privilege for me to introduce the determined resource person, Dr. S. Sivagurunathan, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Applications, Gandhigram Rural Institute, Deemed University, Gandhigram, Dindigul, who is a renowned person for his dedication, hard work, gentleness, and knowledge sharing. He has completed his UG degree in Saraswari Narayanan College, Madurai, in the year 1995, and PG degree in Madurai Kamarajar University in the year 1998, and MPhil in Madurai Kamarajar University in the year 2004, and PhD degree in Anna University in the year 2010. He is having a vast teaching experience for more than 22 years. Under his guidance, three candidates have been awarded PhD degree and nearly 20 plus candidates got MPhil degree. He worked as a principal investigator and co-investigator for two funded projects. And he has presented his work articles in many reputed journals. More than 40 plus articles he has presented, and he has published 7 chapters of book. He has organized and attended more than 30 seminars, conferences, workshops, and has given 35 invited talks in reputed organizations. He has chaired nearly 12 national and international conferences, and he has taken some additional responsibilities like program officer in NSS GRI and staff in charge in department library and placement and alumni activities. And last but not the least, he is our eminent Board of Studies expert member also. It's a great thing to have such an eminent person among us as a resource person. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now over to the resource person.
Very good evening, everybody. It gives me immense pleasure to share some of my knowledge and ideas on emotional intelligence and cognitive abilities with you all in this podium today. At the outset, let me thank the FX and especially the department of MCA, the head of the department, and the faculty members who are all my close friends. As a Board of Studies member, I have interacted with them a lot about the MCA course and the curriculum. So let me thank all the faculty members of MCA FX College for having invited me to share my knowledge on emotional intelligence and cognitive abilities with you all. Thanks to the pleasing introduction about me to Angel ma'am, that she was explaining all aspects of my curricular aspects in the field of computer science. But having given an intro on computer science, and you have asked me to deliver a talk on emotional intelligence, may raise eyebrows in the participants. To be frank with you, being a man from the computer science, I started my journey into the pedagogical aspects of curriculum and education, where I came to know the psychological aspects as educational psychologist and child psychology on imparting knowledge to kids, especially adolescents. So where I came to know about one famous psychologist called Daniel Goleman, who is a famous author on the book Emotional Intelligence. Later on, he went on to write many books on emotional intelligence, like Working with Emotional Intelligence, EQ and IQ, and so on. So this is how I got into EQ. So by reading books on emotional intelligence, in order to impart knowledge to my students, I learned a little bit about EQ and its importance through my journey as a teacher, in order to impart the best of things to my students, and learned and understood that this plays a vital role in one's own learning process. So this is how I personally moved on to interest, got some interest in emotional intelligence and read books on that. Is my little introduction into this to justify the topic for today's session. So with this, I take you to my presentation. Please wait a moment. Let me present my screen. I hope you can see my presentation now. Ma'am, can you see my presentation? Can anyone of you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, thank you. From now on, only my voice will be there, and you can see my presentation by pinning my screen. So, emotional intelligence and cognitive abilities as two major aspects in one's own learning skills. These are all the two aspects that play a vital role in one's learning aspects. So why emotional intelligence? Why people doing specialization in various fields of science, engineering, and other domains need to know little about emotional intelligence is my introduction. So basically, it is defined as, emotional intelligence is defined as the ability to monitor one's own and others' feelings and emotions, to discriminate among them, and to use this information to guide thinking and action. So this is a famous definition by Mayer and Slavery, who defined emotional intelligence as a basic building block for one's own, not only education, but also career and life. So from this definition, we understand emotional intelligence is not all about one individual's feelings and emotion, but also his ability to interact and move with the society at large, and thereby work in order to improve not only his personal skills, but also as a evolve as a leader by moving freely in the society by understanding others' emotions and feelings. So this particular characteristics in emotional intelligence helps us to grasp or have our own idea about our own self and positioning ourselves in a group or a team or a society largely helps us in making our life better both professionally and on the family side. So with this little introduction, I take you to the advanced concepts and aspects that really touches in our everyday life in emotional intelligence. And before that, you may wonder, I assume that many of the participants now are college students, assuming that these participants are in their adolescent or they are just becoming men and women. At this juncture, emotional intelligence plays a vital role because with the kind of energy that they have, they will be swinging back and forth between the various emotions in their life. And it is the time that they have to express their emotions in a controlled way in order to achieve greater things, lead a happy life, and achieve success in their career too. So why emotional intelligence is introduced now, not in the childhood? From childhood, we are controlled, we are administered, we are monitored, we are channelized by our parents and siblings by telling us what to do, what not to do, and so on in our tender age group. And later on, that baton will be handed over to the teachers in the schools and colleges, where they'll tell the students and what is right and what is wrong, and thereby controlling the emotions of the students by channelizing them in the right direction in the life. But this is the time in which, the period in which the students come out of the clutches of both the parents and other teachers, so that they need a controlled emotional life so that they can travel in a journey called life, balancing both personal and professional aspects in life in a successful manner and lead a happy life. So that is the reason why emotional intelligence is the need of the hour. By telling all this, I am trying to bring in a justification, the reason why emotional intelligence is being introduced at this time. Of course, it is required throughout your life for all age groups to handle all life situations. It may be a professional situation or a personal situation or a financial situation. Anything and everything can be managed effectively for a successful, in fact, a happy life, provided you control your emotions. So with this simple justification on the need of having a controlled emotional intelligence, I take you to the very famous identifiers called Mayer and Briggs type indicators. These two are the mother and daughter researchers who have done an extensive research on emotional intelligence, and they have arrived at four major dichotomies on the emotional intelligence. What are they? What these emotional indicators, type indicators, are going to do with our emotion is what we are going to see in this particular slide. So first of all, these emotions are the seeds for the energy source. Emotions gives us energy. Many a times you would have heard about whether we are in the fight mode or flight mode. When there is a fear, when you are jubilant, when you are very happy, you observe your own self. You observe your own self and analyze, where do you get energy? Or it is your birthday. How do you feel without any tiredness? How do you feel energetic throughout the day? Why it is not happening on all other days? So we understand that it is an energy source. Then it is a means for the next two aspects of information gathering and decision making. So when you are in a balanced state of mind, the information that we gather through our senses are in a right perception and in the right dimension and value and weightage. So thereby we collect only the correct information, not an aberrated information. So when you are in a balanced state of emotion and mind and happy mood, the information that you gather will be a right one. So that is the second one. The third one these emotions, when you are in a good state of mind and mood, your decisions will be better. So that is the reason why people used to say, don't take any hasty decisions, when you, especially when you are in a extreme mood swings, either if it is too happy or too sad or too angry. So these are all the some of the emotions which redirect us to take a wrong decision based on the place and the time, based on the mood. So to take right decisions in life, we have to have a balanced mind. So emotional intelligence teaches us to have a balanced mind throughout the day, helping us to take right decision in our life. And above all, coming to the fourth point, it gives the approach to the external world. So in a society, how are we going to position ourselves so that we are taken in the right way, with the right spirit, to present our personality in relation to the situation, place, time, and the people with whom you are interacting with. So these are all some of the major four type indicators using which we can balance our mind to have a good emotional life. And these type indicators, based on the following points, are categorized as these four points will help us to analyze our own self to a level. It is a kind of an introspection of one's own self, evaluation of one's own self based on the past actions, and help us to improve ourselves in the future in the similar circumstances and situation in life and career. So in that aspect, the first category is that extrovert and introvert. As you all know, extrovert is a person who is moving very sociable, who is very sociable and moving with people freely, and will not have any inhibition in moving with people, and is considered as a friend to many. Process all the time, talking to his own self every time, and will not have a good social life. But we need a balanced life in terms of both extrovert and an introvert. We should neither be an introvert nor be an extrovert in order to be a good person. In order to develop a good personality, you have to have a balanced introvert and extrovert attributes in our thinking capacity. The next one is sensing and intuition. So this indicator tells you how are you going to gather information, as we were telling in the previous slide. It refers to how one prefers to deal with information, whether we are going to sense based on the situation or the person who is sitting in the opposite. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Am I audible? Okay.
Yes, sir.
So based on the ability to sense, we gather information, and at times life situation, we have to behave intuitively based on the situation. Say, we cannot sense all the time and gather right information. We cannot go by our intuition to gather the right information all the time. So it is a combination of both in terms of our learning process, acquiring knowledge and skill. It is the next part of the Mayers and the Biggs type indicator. The third one is the thinking and feeling. And this is a common thing, that when are all the times that I am supposed to use my brain? What are all the time when I am going to use my heart? So this is a common ambiguity that happens in one's life. Whether am I going to use my heart or am I going to use my brain? So this is the trade-off between these two that helps us to take decision. The third aspect that we have discussed in the previous slide as the parameter. So it helps you to take right decision at the right time. You cannot apply your brain all the time, and of course you cannot apply your heart all the time. It is the situation and the place and the people that tell you which is to be used at this moment. And finally, the final part that extract the implementation aspect, judging and perceiving. It refers to how one interacts with the outer world in the social life with a preference towards getting things decided already based on our earlier past judgment, you are going to do some action, or for staying open to new information and options dynamically by perceiving. So judgments work better in some situations, perceptions work better in some other situation. So you have to be open. At the same time, you should have the idea or ability to use our past judgment, right? So these four type indicators of the maze and bricks, like whether you are going to act extrovert or introvert, to acquire data, you are going to sense or going to be intuitive, or you are going to always think and act, you are going to apply your mind or heart, and finally you are going to perform action based on your past judgment or perception. So from these type indicators, we understand that as a whole, these are all the major aspects that we face every moment. Now we realize having seen these indicators, now we come to realization that it is our life. Almost I am talking to every moment. Are we living in our moment? This is a question that comes to our mind. Whether we are pondering over the past incident, thinking about the past and ruling over it, or we are dwelling in the future by having too much of aspiration and living in fear. So future leads to fear and past gives you sadness. So in these two aspects, from these indicators, I bring you to the present. Of course, it sounds philosophical to some extent, but practically, living in the present helps you to handle these types of indicators in our day-to-day activities, in our persona, thereby have a balanced emotion. So with this, I take you to the attributes of emotional intelligence on the personal side and on the social side. There are four dimensions to emotional intelligence. One is self-awareness. Self-awareness is tool, or simply saying, it is a personal attitude. It's like self-evaluation in the past, about the past, being in the present, about the present, okay, planning for the future or to the future. So these three bringing together gives you an opinion about you. Or in other words, I can say emotional intelligence on the personal attribute side helps you to have a thought on your own present thinking. So it is like thinking about your thinking. So as I was telling, in your childhood days, your thinking and actions are controlled and monitored by your parents, elders, teachers, largely in shaping you as a complete personality. Not only as a student, not only as an individual, but as a human for the society, in keeping you in the right track. Now, it is time, asking your adolescent, it is time that you have to have your own control. So that is the reason why you feel the freedom outside. Actually, it is not the freedom. So far, the control was on you by an external force in the name of loved ones, parents, teachers. Now you take charge for your own actions and thinking and character, called using self-awareness, and have a thinking idea about your own path, or seeing yourself as a third person. So if you could have a thought or thinking about your present thinking, not only your present action, but also what is running inside your mind about a particular thing, or about a particular situation, or about a particular person, it has to be monitored by another you, okay, called self-awareness, to always judge and control and channelize whether it is right or wrong. If it is right, allow it to blossom or bloom or think in that direction. If it is wrong, control or change the mood or change the situation or change your thinking behavior so that you are channelized in the right direction. So it may sound a kind of advice, but it is not so. It is a personal experience that I would say that it is thinking about your own thinking process. So it is very difficult to bring in as a regular trait But slowly, steadily, by practice, you can recognize and understand your emotions and access your strengths and limitations, and thereby develop your self-confidence. So it is one of the major personal attributes that is given by the self-awareness. And the second attribute, on the personal attribute side, self-management. Okay, having become aware, can I manage my, or control my, or channelize my thought and action so that as long as it is a thought, it is my personal aspect. When it is becoming an action, it affects my affects the people around me. So manage and express your emotions. Use your awareness and choose your appropriate decision. Based on the decision, choose an appropriate action or a word so that you don't act impulsively or you don't quickly react. So the self-management aspect in your personal attribute helps you to respond. So what is the difference between reaction and response? Reaction is the thing that you do immediately after listening to a word or seeing a situation or an interaction or something without thinking. Response is something that you give after applying thinking on the emotion, and you do something or use a word or converse with somebody in a conscious manner, then it is called a response. So we are, as a human being, we are expected to respond and not react for all the situations. Then coming to the social attribute, this next, the first attribute in the social attribute is the social awareness. Where are we now? What is the situation? Who are all the people around us? So how am I supposed to behave in this situation? So the situation varies from place to place, whether we are at home or we are with friends or we are in a classroom or we are in a conference. Okay, so based on the situation, time, place, people around, the social awareness aspect in us can help us to process, store, process, and take decision in our social life. And this helps you to develop the next attribute and feeds input to this attribute called relationship management in the social attribute. The fourth attribute, the second attribute on the social attribute side. So the relationship management uses right emotion at the right time with the right people in the right place using appropriate words and action helps you to have a good social life as a human being. So this relationship management comes in handy provided you have the other three aspects in good, and you are good at using your thought and action appropriate to that of the previous three attributes that we have seen, both on the personal front and the social front. So you can see in the next slide. Am I audible? Is my presentation visible, ma'am?
So
okay.
Yes, sir.
So this slide tells you the self and social life along with the recognition and regulation attributes on the same old attributes. So the self-awareness gives you input both to your self-management, also to the social awareness. So where are we now? Am I alone or am I a part of a group or a team or a place? What is the time? What am I doing? So self-management helps you to move towards your goal. So self-control, adaptability to your current situation, and taking action. Self-management, initiate action, are the functions of the self-management. So these things come if and only if your awareness and your judgment about your own self is right, and thereby you have derived your self-confidence about your abilities, whether it may be a right ability that you assume and think that you carry, and you know what are the things you know completely, and you don't know certain things which you don't know. You are able to accept your weakness. So the self-awareness helps you to accept your weakness also. So the self-awareness facilitates you to handle yourself better in the self-management attitude. On the right-hand side, you can see the social awareness aspect is developed based on your self-awareness, whether we are in an organization, so social awareness, organizational awareness, orientation for that, based on having the empathy about the social life. So these are all the aspects that we actions that we perform in the social
Sir, PPT, life, not shared.
Social life.
Sir, your PPT, sir, your yes, PPT is not shared, sir.
PPT
somebody
is
has presented now. Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir.
Please ask them to leave, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Some of them, yes, sir.
Satya Prabha.
Yes, Satya Prabha. Presented the screen.
Am I visible, ma'am?
No, sir. PPT is not visible, sir. Yes, sir. Now.
Every time I have to go back. That's the problem.
Yes, sir.
Is my screen now? Satya
Prabha, ma'am, could you please mute your audio? Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
So this aspect feeds input, thereby taking us to the relationship management aspect, like leadership as a manager, influencing people, changing, acting like a catalyst for the situation, resolving issues, conflict management, building bonds between the people, amongst the people, collaborate and perform teamwork. So these actions to be a part of a team, help you to grow rich in your life, both on the personal front and the family side, and also on the career front as a member of your institution or organization, wherever you are. So this way, the emotional intelligence, you understand, takes you from emotionally instable to emotionally stable. So the self-awareness, so the emotionally stable state makes you a leader. So the self-awareness tells you the purpose. So you have to be aware, and having set the goal, you know the purpose. You know your purpose. So that is the self-awareness, the extreme point. The social awareness, you know your presence in the place and the team or the institute, wherever you are. The presence is built. Self-management makes you an expert by practice. And relationship management gives you partners, many partners and friends, so that you evolve from a simple man to a great leader. So that is the objective of emotional intelligence. And how am I going to improve this? You can see in this slide how to improve my emotional intelligence in a sense, having a balanced emotion, keeps you in the right spirit and the right place and position, and act accordingly. So these are all the attributes, to my knowledge, that help you to develop your emotional intelligence. The first one is think before you act. So don't act in a hasty manner. The first point. Think on your thinking process and actions that you are about to take, its consequences, everything, then act. Would be a response. So instead of reacting, you can respond. That is the first exercise. The next one is, it naturally reduces the stressful situations, so that it gives you the planning aspect into your life. You plan and go, plan and do, plan and use words, so that it avoids conflict and avoids you becoming stressful. And thereby, this aspect of planning is the next characteristic, that training. That helps you to have a balanced emotion. Then practice, not only having a balanced mind, but also practice according to the cognitive ability that we are going to see in the next part of our presentation. How are we going to control our emotions, both verbally and non-verbally? So at times we may not use words, but our body language tells the other one in what type of mood are we in. So these and all will come, will not come overnight. By practice, by having the third eye on your own individual thinking process, okay, ability to see you as a third person, seeing your thinking, seeing your words, seeing your action as a third person by your own self, helps you to control your emotions. And of course, having explained the non-verbal communication, embrace your emotion. You embrace, you understand, or you agree that whether you are angry or whether you are sad, or tell your loved ones whether you are in a sad mood, you are angry now. Tell your loved ones or people around you that you are in a, not in a good mood to react or respond. Ask them to leave or give time, borrow some time. Nothing wrong in embracing your emotion. Instead of that, don't do anything in a reactive mood. So embrace your emotion is letting yourself know about your current emotion. And thereby, if you are too angry, don't speak or don't do anything. If you are too happy, don't give any promise or something kind of thing. So by having an awareness about our own emotion, we embrace the situation and handle the situation better. And ultimately, finally, you take the responsibility and ownership for the action that you take as a response to all this. So you take an action after thinking, after contemplation on the thinking and the action, you perform an action, use a word, you take the responsibility and ownership that gives you confidence. And ultimately, you demonstrate humility with humor with people in the society, and the social aspect will position you as a good, not only as a good human being, but also as a leader, a member of the team, a likable member who is wanted by everybody for any situation. Thereby, you can make your life easier and better and effective, happy and successful. So the important aspect about emotional intelligence is by proper regular training. So all these aspects of training will come to you if you are aware of you, self-aware. You are in the present. You are in the present all the time to observe what is going inside you. And based on that, you respond to any situation, action. You have a plan. You have a goal. You move towards it. Then your life will be better. So with this, I take you to the next part of our topic, where we are going to talk about the cognitive skills and abilities. So what is a cognitive ability? So cognition is literally defined as, it has to do with how a person understands the world, acts in it. It is a set of mental ability, collectively a set of abilities or processes that are part of nearly every human action. Every human action while we are awake, not while sleeping. So every human mental ability and process is the base for the action. So anything that is related to a brain activity, mental ability, your ability tells you what is that you are capable of. It's called cognition. So what is it ultimately? Why should I talk about this here? So cognitive abilities are brain-based skills we need to carry out any task from the simplest to most complex. So least known, you always move from known to unknown. You cannot straight away move to unknown thing. You have certain known things based on your past experience. Slowly move from known to unknown. Now the unknown becomes known. From that unknown, you move to another unknown. Then that unknown becomes known. So like that, we learn every aspect in our life, in our human life. There we become knowledgeable person. So to be a knowledgeable person, or a learned person, or a skillful person, you have to hone your skill, develop your skill. Called these cognitive abilities, some of them are natural. Some of them are natural. We'll see them one by one. But before that, these have more to do with the mechanisms of how we learn, how we remember, how do we solve problem, and how do we pay attention, focus, give focus, rather than with any actual knowledge. So these are all the important aspects of life. So, whether how are we going to learn things, how are we going to remember for the long period of time certain things, keep our memory abreast, how are we going to approach a problem, solve, ability to solve problem, how are we pay attention, how are we going to pay attention, focus on things, or to take decisions, or to acquire knowledge, or to exert a skill to be skillful. So these abilities are, we each one of us are born with certain natural ability. If you are lucky, these abilities match with your career requirements and you become successful. So that is the reason why we talk about cognitive ability. So for example, let's take a simple situation of answering a phone, answering a telephone. It involves a perception. You, through your senses, you hear the ringtone, without which you cannot pick up a call. So it is sensory organ through which you perceive there is a ring in the telephone. You take a decision whether to attend the call or not. So decision making comes into picture. Then you have a motor skill. You lift the receiver. Your brain gives a signal to activate your hand, or sometimes many of the times we do actions unconsciously, naturally, inherently. We do actions by lifting the receiver once the decision is taken. So it is a motor skill. Then language skill. You are talking, you are comprehending your thought, your knowledge, you share. So your ability to speak, language skill comes into picture. Then your social skill, with whom you are interacting, what is your modulation, what is your tone, what is your pitch. These play a vital role in the conversation with whom you are conversing. So in a simple act of attending a telephone, you see various attributes, cognitive abilities come into play. So which means from this you understand, we require all types of cognitive abilities to lead our life. There is no question. There is no question about having all these cognitive abilities. Yes, accept that. Now, is that enough? No. You will be having certain basic abilities in all these aspects, all these abilities. You have to develop certain abilities, proper training by understanding what are all the abilities and exposing yourself to various aspects of life, language skill, creative skill, leadership skill, motor skill. For that, you indulge in various actions in your life, thereby understand which ability, which cognitive ability in you is your best or which is close to your heart. Sometimes you will not be able to recognize your close one, your loved ones, or your friends who is very close to you can observe and tell you that you are good at it. And before going to that, first let us understand what are all the cognitive abilities and how they play a role in the human life. So the first ability is the perception. Perception is the ability that we get through our senses, sensory stimuli, by smelling, by touching, by listening, by seeing. In fact, seeing is the ultimate thing. Other senses are present in the body. They receive signals from various parts, whether it is smelling or tasting or touching. They receive what is coming to it. The eye is a different perceptive organ, where it goes and perceives things. You see so many things in front of your eyes, but you see or you concentrate or focus on only things which you like. Say you go on the roadside. There are so many things on a road, on a street. Okay. So what do you see? You don't see what you see. The famous saying, you don't see what you see what you want to see. So if you go on a road, a motor vehicle specialist, say automobile engineer, will see a car, is the type of the car, what is the nature of, what is the PS of the car, like that. There is a shopkeeper, which kind of business will go in this street, for all the people walking, what is the lifestyle, which shop is crowded, like that. Okay, suppose if you are an artist, you will see the codings in the shops, how creative they are, how colorful they are. So like that, people based on their training and objective and their life goal, will see different things on the same road. All these aspects are on the same road, okay? But people don't see everything. People see what they really want to see. All other things will be visible to their eyes, but they don't think about all those things in the in their eyes, but they focus on certain things in the street. I leave it to your imagination. Why I is such a enemy to us in a lighter vein, I would say, goes and catches things according to our emotions and goal setting and training. So we have to be very careful with our senses too. That is our friend. They are all our friends, and at the same time, they are all our enemies. If they are emotionally charged, wrongly directed, they kill our energy and the emotion, thereby our life. So perceptive ability is the first attribute on the cognitive skill. Next one is attentive skill. Ability to sustain concentration, give focus on a particular object. Thereby you learn and take decision and respond. And for that, the attentive skill is very important to acquire skill. The third ability is a motor skill. The ability to mobilize our muscles, bodies, move, swim, climb, all that abilities are called motor skills. Based on that, we, of course, to some extent, it requires a physical agility and ability, body, to exert motor skills. So you understand abilities like perception, focus, call attention, motor skills, then visual and spatial processing. You could have seen certain people who are all very good at geography. You leave them in any street, they will come back to home quickly, even in an unknown place, by some natural stimuli, like what is east, what is west, where is the river, where is the mountain. They climb on to the highest location. They decide on the place where they want to go. Like that, their visual images and the scenario, their spatial data processing ability, help them to. That's the reason why in many places where we go, how to go to a particular location, they help you quickly to find out the place. And of course, memory. Some people will have very sharp memory. Some people will have very broad memory. Some people will have very long-term memory. So they have different types of abilities. That's the reason why in the tender ages, students are asked to memorize certain verses, songs, that help you to improve your memory. There is nothing wrong in memorizing. In pedagogy, there is a wrong understanding, misunderstanding about even among the educationalists. People say memory-based education is not good. Of course, not good for the understanding-based concepts, but to some extent, your memory helps you to quickly access data in the memory to process the data and take decisions. So you need a particular amount of quick memory for a long time with a broad knowledge. So memory is an important requirement, but not for all types of pedagogical levels. People say in pedagogy, you acquire knowledge in different levels. Remember, understand, analyze, apply, kind of things. You'd have seen your outcome-based education. Okay, many of you heard of teachers. In outcome-based education, people say, what is the outcome? Whether it is recitation or it is an analysis or whether it is creative kind of thing. So remember part is done by the memory. Then language skill. So language skill, usually, as you know, some people are very good at communication, both verbally and non-verbal communication. They translate their thoughts into sounds, and they will be very good at certain some languages or even many languages. They are very proficient. They will be quick learners of languages. Some may be very good at speaking. Some may be good at writing. So these are some of the cognitive abilities. Of course, remember that all these abilities are very basic and based on the proper guidance and training and objective and motivation, we can develop all these skills. We have been developing. We had developed from our tender ages, from childhood to till date, we have developed so many skills on all these aspects of our cognitive abilities, whether it is a motor skill or a memory skill or a creative skill or a language skill. In all these aspects, we have grown to a level. But it is your duty and your foremost requirement to identify which is best to you or which is close to your heart or in which you are vested. By now you should have chosen or identified it. If you are not able to recognize your own best cognitive ability, or if at all you don't know how to train it, you ask your close ones, people who are around you all the time, they'll be able to recognize you. You are good at creation. If you write verses, you write, you draw something, your creative skill come into picture. Say, suppose you are a student, I assume many of you are students, many of you are computer science students especially. Suppose you feel that you are very creative, which job to pursue in computer industry? You can be a web developer, designer, like kind of thing where you require much of creative skills. So you can match, adapt your skill to your career. So you'll become successful naturally. Suppose your critical ability is very good. You are quick in finding faults. Your ability to find the faults and find a mistake is good. Then you can become a software testing engineer. You can be a tester. You can find the fault quickly. Suppose your analytical skill is good. You are able to analyze things properly. So you can become an analytics expert. You can become an analyzer. Big data analytics kind of areas will help you. Suppose you are good at logic, reasoning, construction. Then you can become a programmer, pure programmer. You become a Java programmer. Programming language is your trait, your art. So that comes natural to you. So like that, by matching your natural ability with the kind of profession with which you are associated with, you can be successful. That is the very reason why we talk about cognitive ability, okay? And develop that. It will not help you. Your birth level ability will not help you to be successful. That birth ability has to be properly nurtured, trained, honed, so that these skills are developed to the maximum level to become an expert, so that you can be successful. Not that by birth straight away you can be an expert, provided you identify your expertise in a particular cognitive ability. So coming to the abilities, the final ability called executive ability, there comes a number of abilities, the abilities that enable goal-oriented behavior, such as ability to plan and execute your goal. Some of them are flexibility, ability to quickly switch from one mental mode to another mental mode. Flexibility, you attend a class, you move to your playground, then you quickly move to your refreshment area, or you go to your home. You don't go with the same mood. Many a times office goers come with the same mood from the office. They chide at the people at the home. When you come home, you switch your mood. That's your ability called flexibility. So that you are a family man now, how are you going to respond to the situation at home? So that is the thing. Then theory of mind. Insight into people's inner world, their plans, their liking and disliking. So you understand the people around you and your own mind. So your ability to recognize, call it executive function. You become a manager. You become a leader. Then anticipation skill, predictive skill. Of course, you should not be judgmental. And at the same time, you should be able to predict based on the past event, logic, reasoning, pattern matching. So these aspects of your abilities in the cognitive level, by developing that, you can improve your predictions. Predictions go right many a times. Then problem solving ability. If your problem solving ability is good, you can be a programmer. You break down a complex problem, a computationally solvable problem. A complex problem can be boiled down to smaller steps and simple steps in a linear sequence. Thereby you bring it solvable. Of course, decision making ability, it is another execution function. Ability to make decisions based on the analysis and outcome and past experience, judgment, perception, you take right decision. And of course, if you have made some wrong decision, you adjust your past knowledge and correct it so that in future you take a right decision. So there is no wrong decision. Either it is a learning or a right decision. That's it. Okay, then working memory, your capacity to hold and manipulate information. So your ability to manipulate make you dynamic, online. Then self-regulation. This ability is to identify and manage one's own emotions, as we have discussed all these things in our emotional intelligence for our better performance. So these are some of the executive level abilities at the cognitive level. So we have seen the major cognitive abilities like perception through our senses, attention through our focus, motor skills through our training, visual and social geographical processing ability for our maneuvering, memory for our remembering, language for our communication, and of course all other executive functions in terms of flexibility, judging, anticipation, problem solving, and of course decision making, and based on that using your working memory to manipulate things and make life better as a whole. When I say life, it's both personal and professional. So both these aspects can be handled. People often say how good you are in handling, juggling your personal and professional life. Actually, they are not opposite. They are not mutually exclusive. One feed to other. If you are professionally good, your personal life will be better. If your personal life is better, professionally you will be to some extent successful. I can say confidently this. You cannot be professionally successful too much. Even if it is considered, it is not a true success. So the other aspects, I have missed this. The sequencing ability as another executive functionality, the ability to break down complex action into manageable units, prioritization, right and wrong, ordering, and inhibition, the ability to withstand a distraction and internal urge or internal blocks, how good you are in shunning or avoiding the inhibition, are some of the cognitive abilities that actually helps you to make your life better. We are at the end of the cognitive abilities, recognizing the cognitive ability. That is the reason why at the young age you are asked to expose yourself to various life skills. If you are a young student with energy, I would recommend you to go and do all types of activity, right from memorizing certain songs, maybe a ritual or maybe a religious song or maybe a cultural song or maybe anything. Try memorizing everything. Every day do some memorization. Every day do some motor skill. Try your hand in motoring, swimming, climbing kind of thing. Then try every day a new thing, creative work, maybe singing, dancing, drawing, writing a verse kind of thing. Try your hand in solving a problem. Try a problem. Try to analyze the problem. Try a solution. Try all these things every day. Every day do one thing for every cognitive ability. Then at the end of a month or 2 months time, you see which one or which aspect in your activities is good. If you are not able to judge yourself, ask your friends or you ask your parents, ask your elders or even your teacher. Show all your progress in all these aspects. They will be in a position to tell you that you are good at this. Then decide what is your career choice. Then decide the career based on your ability. Don't stop there. Develop that skill every day. Don't forget other skills. Have a knowledge, little knowledge about all these cognitive abilities. But of course, focus on one particular skill. Have some exercises on nurturing, honing that skill, developing that skill so that you become an expert in that. Provided your expertise matches with your career choice, you become successful. If you are successful, naturally your life becomes very successful. Your career will be so successful. So naturally your life will be too good. And coming to training of mind, there is one more aspect to it. There are two types of thoughts that we face every day. One is inward thought and an outward thought. I gave an example that we see a road. On a road, you see so many things, but we don't see everything. We see what we want to see. We don't see what we see. We see what we actually want to see, to which our brain and emotion is attached with. We see only that thing. Based on our knowledge and our objective, our goal in life, we see only one thing in life. right? Like that, it is an inward thought. You see something, you smell something, you touch something, your thought process starts, initiates from that thing and is growing. Your thought is increasing. As a chain of thoughts, you are getting so many consecutive cascading of chain of thoughts coming in the same line. Then it is an inward thought firing or activating your thought process. Imagine an outward thought is something. You have decided to write something. You have decided to create something. Now you forget about your situation. Your eyes may be watching something, but you will be internally creating an outward thought. You will be trying to write a verse. You may be writing a kavide, a verse, or you may be trying to draw a figure which is in your brain. You will be in the process of drawing. Nothing around you will disturb you. So this is an outward thought. So try to have more of outward thought than of inward thought. Inward thought is a majority of the time coming through your senses. Much of our time during your day, you will not be in the right mood with the goal-oriented objective all the time. So your senses take you to a different line. You will not be towards your goal, you will not be focused. So an outward thought. So you have to have a plan, a time management, a time for everything and everything in your time. So you have time for play, you have time for swimming, you have time for studies, you have time for your creative art, you have time for your family, you have time for your entertainment. So in that time, you are only your outward thought. This is the entertainment. This is that I am going to do. This is the action that I am going to do. I am going to do a practice in swimming. I am going to swim. I have to do this action. Like that, your outward thought is on that particular action that you do. Actually, naturally helps you to train your mind more than your inward thought. Many of the time, your inward thought will make you more of your energy will be sucked on unnecessary things, moving into taking you to different emotions in life. In a short span of 5 minutes, if you observe, an inward thought will take you an object that you see through your eyes, your senses, will take you to different emotion object based on that you see, you remember a past event, your past friend's word, your friend or your teacher or something. Based on his word, you will think on something else. Based on that, you will think on something else. Like that, you will be taken a ride. It is a ride of different, ride into different emotional roller coaster. Finally, you go exhausted. That's the reason why many a times you see people, it is boring. Why it is boring? Because you give birth to, you lead, you allow your senses to do inward thought. So that's the reason why you don't know what to do. You don't allow outward thought. You just process whatever comes to you, whatever is the situation in which you are in. That takes you to a roller coaster of different thoughts and emotions. You feel sucked of your energy. So that's the reason why many a time it is not the work that sucks our energy. It is the idleness that sucks the energy. Work actually is a joy. If you work on an interested project, work on a thing which is close to your heart, you derive energy actually. You don't see the time. You realize that you have spent too much of time on something. Actually, we'll be thinking that it is a short period of time. So that is the reason. If you do things in an outward thought, your energy will be saved. Even for a long period of time, you don't feel exhausted. If you allow inward thought, you feel exhausted. So this way you can train your mind to have a outward thought for a million times. This is possible if and only if you are goal-oriented, you are focused, and you know your regular time schedule, you are proper in scheduling your activities, you stick to your time, you are harsh on you, you work on your time-based activity, then naturally you ought to be become an expert and thereby successful. I hope you understand what I am trying to say. Okay, with this I conclude. We have come to the end of it. Largely on the latter part on the cognitive ability, we have discussed about the IQ part, intelligent quotient. So to summarize, the EQ, the emotional quotient, and the IQ, intelligent quotient, are the two important attributes that play a vital role in every aspect of our life. So that help you to have a good physical structure, physical, we call it as physical well-being, action that you do yoga and outward thought, activity, mental well-being, you have time for your friends and family, social well-being, you have time to hone your improve your knowledge and hone your skill, career well-being, that gives you a job and a career, you become an entrepreneur, your financial, you settle in your life, your financial well-being is taken care of, you become successful, provided you have all these well-being. Not a single well-being is enough. We need to have all these well-being, not only finance, not only career, not only social. We have to have all these aspects of life in terms of physical, mental, social. People also say spiritual. I incorporate that as part of mental, social life, career life, reputation, financial life, so that you can spend on the things, needs taken care of. So all this life, all these aspects will be completely taken care of if you are good at identifying your skill, your natural ability, develop that ability. I come back and again reiterate that you identify your natural skill, that is the first part. You develop that natural skill, that is the second part. Match that natural skill with the profession, that is the third part. You become successful. Provided after acquiring the expertise in the cognitive ability, you maintain balanced emotion, your emotional quotient is also good, you become very happy and successful on both the aspects. You can balance your life and the personal life and career life, career on both the fronts. Ultimately, your life will be completely taken care of so that you can be happy and joyful. So with this, I stop my presentation with a happy, with happiness that I have shared my little knowledge on the emotional intelligence and cognitive abilities, my best of my knowledge, and I take this opportunity to thank each one of you for your patient listening, and once again to the Department of MCA, and most importantly to the head of the department, and also to FX College for having invited me to share my knowledge on emotional intelligence and cognitive abilities. If you have any specific question to ask, you can post your queries now, either directly or you can type your question in the chat box so that I can try my best to answer those questions and help you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your wonderful presentation. Hope so. Your content is very clear. So nobody posted the queries, sir. They are fully satisfied, I think so, sir.
Let me go through the chat box, ma'am. Is there, if there are any questions, let me
okay, sir. So is there any queries? You can post the queries, the participants.
I don't think there is any questions, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Your presentation is wonderful, sir. Sir, one question. Can you explain? Sir, they have started asking the queries, sir. Stanley, sir.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
The first question is, can you explain EI in AI? We can train all the.
Yes,
AI.
Sir. You are welcome.
Sir, actually, this is the question which was asked by the participant. The question is,
okay,
can you explain EI in AI? We can train all the EI.
I don't think so, sir. Because EI, we largely talk about emotions. Hello, am I audible?
Okay, sir.
We talk about emotions, where AI is a subject that we study to take decisions or help the computer to take decisions on behalf of us. So there is no question of emotion there. So AI comes into picture whenever you want to analyze and take decision or to control aspects in life on a computational platform. And another aspect, in my understanding, AI is a subject where you expect your input is your past data and its results, your output is your program. Whereas in all other subjects, you will be giving an input, you will be writing a program, you will be expecting an output. Where AI is a unique subject, where you give huge volume of data as input and output, based on the input and output, the computer has to write its own program to produce that kind of output, so that the output is the program. I hope you understand.
Sir, the next question is, yes, how to improve the intelligence level of a slow learner?
Slow learner, coming to it, of course, some students learn quickly some aspects. Some may memorize quickly, some may analyze and understand quickly, some may do good at creative works. Okay, let's not say straight away that all are slow learners. Some learners will be slow in memorizing, some learners will be slow in analyzing, some learners will be slow in creative skills. So we have to give enough time for the students and tell them that they are not slow learners, they are not capable. We have to tell them some people will memorize in quick time. So if you spend more time on memorizing, you will be good at it. Whereas the same student cannot analyze and understand quickly. So this student may be better in that. Okay. So much of our time in our educational system, we evaluate based on their memory power. That is the problem. Provided our objective in evaluation is correct in identifying the right skill, if our pattern of evaluation is correct, we can say or identify the right mistake in the student, correct aspect. Whether he is poor in memory, or whether he is poor in logic, or whether he is poor in creative skill like that, you have to ask the student to analyze his own cognitive abilities to come out. Some have to work longer period of time. That is the thing. So you have to impart or educate the slow learners by telling all these aspects of life, spending time with him, and motivating on the ability he carries naturally, and thereby we can improve. And of course, as I was telling, that by proper training, spending time regularly only will help you. Overnight, you cannot acquire a new skill quickly.
Okay, sir. And the next question is, sir, what is the role of EQ in the balance of life?
EQ plays a very, very vital role in the life. That's the reason why that you can see the research happening in EQ proved that the most successful people today in the world, or happy people in the world today, are not the most intelligent people. Of course, they may be quick in getting a job or quick in making money, big money. But the world now has realized that they are not happy. So the happiness quotient is decided by the EQ, emotional quotient. Okay, so it is not your intelligence alone that helps you to be happy. It might have helped them to land in a good job in a young age, or earn good money in a short period of time. Might be there, but you see their life, whether they are happy. Okay, the happy people are the ones who are content, and they know their emotion. They are actually the happy people.
So thank you very much, sir, for your valuable answers.
Thank you.
Participants, if you have any sort of queries, you can just type it in the chat box.
Okay.
Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful answers. Okay, sir.
Thank you, Shiva Gurunathan, sir, for your wonderful speech. Hope this will be very useful for the participants. Kindly fill the feedback form given in the chat box. Now I request Mrs. D. Angelin Renjithamani, HOD of MCA department, to propose the vote of thanks.
Again, a very good evening to another present here. First of all, I'd like to thank our Almighty God for this live webinar. And I'd like to thank our resource person, eminent resource person, Dr. Sivagurunathan sir, for his wonderful and valuable speech. And thank you so much, sir. It is, hope so it will be very useful for all the participants. And it's highly motivational speech, sir. Thank you so much. And I'd like to thank our department faculties for their valuable cooperation in organizing this webinar in a very successful manner. And I would like to thank the participants from various institutions and various industries and from Francis Xavier Engineering College for their valuable presence and valuable listening. Then thank you so much. Once again, I thank you all for this webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Participants, kindly fill the feedback form given in the chat box.